ראשית חכמה, יראת ירד, סכרתו וחלוסי, תהילתו עומדת לך, והוא רחוק מחבר המון ולא ישליט, והרבה תחשיבתו ולא יאיר כל חמתו. בפיר אב ירד, is beginning with wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do thereafter. His praise endures forever. And he, being merciful, forgives iniquity and does not destroy. Frequently he turns away his anger and does not stir up all his wrath. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not do the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Amen.
Yehovah, Yehovah, El Rachum Vechanun, Erech Apayim Virab Chesed Ve'emet, Notzer Chesed Lalafim, Nosei Avon, Vafesha Vechatapa, Enake. Yehovah, Yehovah, God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy unto the thousandth generation, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin and pardoning. Amen. 18. They shall rule B'nai Israel et Hashabbat, la'asor et Hashabbat l'rotam rit olam. B'nai Yumei B'nai Israel, quoti l'erolam, ki sheshet yamim, עשה יהוה את השמיים ואת הארץ, וביום השביעי שבת ונפש. And the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever, that in 6 days Yehovah made the heavens and the earth, and on the 7th day he ceased from work and rested.
Matovu, O Halecha Yaakov, Mishkenotecha Yisrael, Vani Berot Hasdecha Avovetecha,
mercy, Elohim, answer me with the truth of your salvation.
These things have you done, and should I have kept silence?
You had thought that I was altogether such a one as yourself, but I will reprove you and set the cause before your eyes. Now consider this, you did forget not a lie, lest I tear in pieces, and there be none to deliver. Whosoever offers the sacrifice of thanksgiving honors me, and to him that orders his way aright will I show the salvation of Elohim. Page 34. Refaenu di Erua Venera Fe, Oshienu Nevashea, Kite Hilatenu Marta, Mehala, Aruha, Marpe, the Hal, the Halmenu, the Hal, Mahomenu, the Hal, Mahotin. Heal us, di Erua, and we shall be healed. Save us, and we shall be saved, for you are our praise. And bring complete recovery for all our ailments. May it be your will, di Erua, my Elohim, and the Elohim of my forefathers, that you quickly send a complete recovery from heaven, spiritual healing and physical healing, to the patient, Batzion, among the other patients of Israel. For you are Elohim, King, the faithful and compassionate healer. Blessed are you, Yahweh, who heals the sick of his people, Israel. Amen. Page 51. Baruch HaElohim Avi Adonenu Yeshua HaMashiach Asher Baruchu Bachal Birchot HaRuach Bashamayim LaMashiach. Blessed be Elohim, the Father of our Master Yeshua HaMashiach, who blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heaven in Mashiach, even as He chose us beforehand in Him, before the foundation of the world, we might be sanctified in Him, and without blemish before Him, and in love He marked us out beforehand to Himself, and He established us as sons by Yeshua HaMashiach, as was pleasing to His will, that the glory of His grace might be glorified, which He poured out upon us by His beloved One, by whom we have redemption and the forgiveness of sins, by His blood, according to the riches of His grace, which has abounded in us, in all wisdom and all spiritual understanding. And He has made us know the mystery of His will, which He had before determined in Himself to accomplish in the stewardship of the fullness of times, that all things might again be made new in Mashiach, things in heaven and on earth. To Him who is able in might to do for us more than all, and more than we can seek or imagine, according to His strength that has redeemed us, to Him is the glory in His congregation, in Messiah Yeshua, in all generations, forever and ever. Amen. 58. Baruch atah, Yahweh, Eloheinu, Melech haolam, asher natan lanu et derecha Yeshua b'Mashiach Yeshua. Blessed are you, Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who has given us a way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. He walked among us filled with the Ruach, the only one who ever fulfilled the word Torah. He healed the sick and raised the dead. The multitudes of our people sought His touch. He taught as no man taught. With authority He brought forth the treasures of the Torah. How the children sought Him, the lepers He touched and made clean. How the despised and outcast found love and release from their sin. How the hypocrites feared Him whose words uncovered their sin. Despised and rejected, acquainted with grief, He bore the sins of Israel. All we like sheep have gone astray, turned every one to his own way. Our iniquities were laid upon the King, the sins of the world His burdens bear. He rose from the dead and opened the way to life everlasting. Praise His name. We are in Him, His Ruach and powers. New life is ours with joy and peace. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua, our King. Baruch atah, Yahweh, Eloheinu, Melech haolam, asher natan lanu Mashiach Yeshua, our King. 59. En kumoch haElohim, Yahweh, ve'en kemaasecha. Malchutecha malchut kol haolamim. Mem shalom ezekhal dor vador. ירוע מלך, ירוע מלך, ירוע ימלוך לעולם ועד, ירוע עוז לעמו, ייתן ירוע יברך את עמו ובשלום. There is none like you among the gods, Yahuwah, and there is nothing that compares to your deeds. Your kingdom is a kingdom that endures for all eternity, and your sovereignty extends throughout all generations. Yahuwah reigns. Yahuwah has reigned. Yahuwah will reign throughout eternity. Yahuwah will bless his people with peace.
Avrachamim hetivav yatzonecha etzion, ki nechomot Yerushalayim. Kirecha levad batachnu, melech el ram benisa, adon olamim.
Father of compassion, deal kindly with Zion, according to your will. Rebuild the walls of Yerushalayim, for we trust in you alone, O King, revered in our Elohim, master over the entire universe.
Vayehi b'insoa aron vayoher moshe, ruma yehovah, ve'afutsu oyedecha, ve'anusu
When the ark went forward, Moshe would say, Arise, O Yahuwah, let your enemies be scattered. Let those who hate you flee from before you. For from Zion shall go forth the Torah, and the word of Yahuwah, Blessed be he who in holiness gave the Torah to his people, Israel.
Shema
שמו. גדלו ליהוה איתי, ונרום מה שמו יחדיו. מי כמוך בעלים, יהוה, מי כמוך נאדר בקודש, נורא תהילות, ועושה ואלה. Who is like you among the gods, O Yehovah? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in praises, doing wonders? Amen.
Jason. Page 62. מי שברך אבותינו, אברהם, יצחק ויעקב, הוא יברך את ישוע שעלה לכבוד המקום ולכבוד התורה. הקדוש, ברוך הוא, ישמרהו ויצילהו מכל צרה וצוקה, מכל נגע ומחלה, וישלח ברכה והצלחה בכל מעשה ידיו. אמן.
May he who blessed our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may he bless Jason, who has come up to honor this place and to honor the Torah. May the Holy One bless him, protect him, and deliver him from all tribulation and oppression, and from every plague and illness, and may he send blessing and prosperity on all the work of his hands. Amen.
Baruch Yahweh, Hamimura. Vayikra 4, verses 1 through 7. And Yahweh spoke unto Moshe, saying, Speak unto B'nai Israel, saying, If anyone shall sin through error in any of the things which Yahweh has commanded not to be done, and shall do any one of them, if the anointed Kohen shall sin so as to bring guilt on the people, then let him offer for his sin, which he has sinned, a young bullock without blemish unto Yahweh, for a chatat. And he shall bring the bullock unto the door of the Ohel Moed before Yahweh, and he shall lay his hand upon the head of the bullock and kill the bullock before Yahweh. And the anointed Kohen shall take of the blood of the bullock and bring it to the Ohel Moed. And the Kohen shall dip his finger in the blood and sprinkle of the blood seven times before Yahweh in front of the parochet of the sanctuary. And the Kohen shall put of the blood upon the horns of the Mizbeach Ketoret before Yahweh, which is in the Ohel Moed. And all the remaining blood of the bullock shall he pour out at the base of the Mizbeach Haolah, which is at the door of the Ohel Moed.
Amen.
Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who selected good prophets, delighting in your words, which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, who chose the Torah, your servant Moshe, and your people Israel, and the prophets of truth and righteousness. The Haftorah portion is from Yeshayahu 44, verses 2 through 6. Thus says Yahweh that made you, and formed you from the womb. Who will help you? Fear not, O Yaakov, my servant, and you, Yeshurun, whom I have chosen. For I will pour water upon the thirsty land and streams upon the dry ground. I will pour my ruach upon your seed and my blessing upon your offspring. And they shall spring up among the grass as willows by the watercourses. One shall say, I belong to Yahweh, and another shall call himself by the name of Yaakov, and another shall subscribe with his hand unto Yahweh, and surname himself by the name of Israel. Thus says Yahweh, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, Yahweh Tsevaot, I am the first and I am the last, and beside me there is no God.
Amen.
Listen, O you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, Rock of all ages, righteous throughout all generations. You are the faithful God, promising and then performing, first heeding and then fulfilling. For all your words are true and righteous. Faithful are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim. Faithful are your words, for no word of yours shall remain unfulfilled. You are faithful and merciful, Elohim. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, who are faithful in fulfilling all your words. Have mercy on Zion, who is the fountain of our life, and very soon deliver her and grieve Zion. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, who made Zion rejoice with your children, and make joyful, O Yahweh, our Elohim, with the power of Eliyahu, your servant, and with the kingdom of the house of David, your anointed. May Eliyahu come soon and bring joy to our hearts. Allow no shame to sit on the dumbing stone, O America's Lord. For by your holy name you swore to him that his light would not be quenched forever. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, the shield of the dumbing.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natzah lanu Mashiach Yeshua. Ha'marim shabrik ha'rasha, Baruch atah Adonai, Notei brik ha'rasha. Amen.
The brik ha'rasha portion is from Romans 8, 1 through 9. There is therefore no condemnation to them who walk not after the flesh in Yeshua HaMashiach, for the Torah of the Ruach HaChayim, which is in Yeshua HaMashiach, has made you free from the law of sin and death. For the Torah was weak because of the weakness of the flesh. So Elohim sent his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin, in order to condemn sin by his means of flesh, that the tzedakah of the Torah might be fulfilled in us. For we do not walk after the things of the flesh, but after the ruach. For they who are after the flesh mind the things of the flesh, but they who are after the Ruach mind the things of the Ruach. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and shalom, because the carnal mind is enmity against Elohim, for it is not subject to the Torah of Elohim, because it cannot be. So then, they who are in the flesh cannot please Elohim, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Ruach, if the Ruach of Elohim truly dwells within you. Now if any man does not have the Ruach of Mashiach, he does not belong to him.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natah lanu devar emet, v'chayei olam natah betochenu. Baruch atah Adonai, notei brit ha'chadasha. Amen.
This is the Torah which Moshe passed before the children of Israel. It is in accord with the command of Yahweh by the hand of Moshe. The tree of life it is for those who take hold of it, and blessed are the ones who support it. Its ways are ways of blessedness, and all its paths are peace. Long life is in its right hand, and in its left are riches and honor. Yahweh is pleased for the sake of his righteousness to render the Torah great and glorious.
Amen. Thank you.
may be seated. Shabbat Shalom. Our portion is Vayikra, and he called to Moshe, and Yahweh spoke to him out of the Ohel Moed, the tent of appointment. A couple of things I want to do today. We're going to go real deep. And so I told the men, and it may come up again in the message here, but I told the men this morning that as I was thinking about all of these offerings that we've been reading about, I was thinking of a gemstone that was multifaceted, that you could look at it in from different directions and see different facets of it, see different light shining through it, see a different perspective on it. And that's really what these offerings are. All of them are a picture of Messiah, but it's a oneness of offering, if you will, and hopefully you can understand that. But it's just each one of them is a different facet on the gemstone that is our redemption. Are you with me? Because Yeshua had to fulfill all of the Torah, and one of the biggest parts of him fulfilling the Torah was becoming our offering. And he's the offering, he's the only offering, he's the only legitimate offering that we can present before Elohim right now. And so, but at the same time, and we've been talking about this for a few weeks, this Mishkan and everything in it is a picture of Messiah. The menorah by itself is a picture of Messiah. The table of the bread of the presence is a picture. The altar of incense is a picture of Messiah. The altar out there is also a picture of Messiah. But along those lines, the Mishkan itself, with all those things inside of it, is a picture of Messiah. And it's a tent of appointment. You could say destiny if you really wanted to stretch it a bit. But that's not a stretch. That's not a stretch too far, because it's all man's destiny to deal with that tabernacle, the body of Messiah. In our last couple of portions, we had a man named Oholiab ben Achisamach. And his name, I gave it to you a little wrong. It wasn't absolutely wrong. It was just a little bit of a stretch. I gave you sort of a mystical version of the last portion of his name. But if you take his name literally, it means the tent of my father and my appointed brother. And this, of course, is the guy that made all the stuff that goes in the tent, right? And inside of this tabernacle that person made, and all of this is leaning toward, it's all moving, it's a destiny moving toward the Messiah. Inside of it is all of the stuff that we see. And that's where all of these offerings are brought. But into the Beit HaMikdash is where the blood was brought in order to make atonement for the offerings that were made outside the door. Are you with me? And if you're thinking in the configuration of our synagogue here, our little makeshift synagogue here, the door would be on the other side, right? Be outside this door. All right, so this is the front door of the tent itself. Is everybody with me? There's the altar. Okay. Some of the blood is sprinkled in, and it depends on which offering you're looking at. And if you haven't read your portion, I'll just explain real briefly that Leviticus 1 through 6 is about the different forms of offerings that they were to bring to the tabernacle. Okay? And we're going to go through those. I'm going to try to teach you briefly about each of those. But inside, if the blood was brought inside, there was, you know, most of the time there was sprinkling going on outside, and then some of the times the sprinkling was going on inside, and there's different variations of that. All of these sprinklings allude to the Messiah in some way, and all of it points to his one atonement for us. Even though there's multiple atonements being seen here, all of it points to the one that he's already given us. Many times that blood was brought into the tabernacle, And in these sacrifices that we read about, it was brought up to sometimes one time up to the very door, the parochet, this curtain in front of the Holy of Holies, the Kadosh HaKadoshim. Okay? I'm going to talk about all of that and try to explain all these things to you. I have to go slow because I don't want to lose anyone. So inside of the door of the tent, which is right here, are all the things that we've been talking about for a few weeks. And I'm just going to review them really quickly. The Mizbeach Ketoret, the altar of incense, which is what this represents. The Shulchan Halechem HaPanim, the bread of the presence, sat on this side. That's what that represents. The menorah and the Ner Tamid. The menorah is the lamp with the eternal light on it. That one flame was always burning. At dusk, the rest of them would be lit. But there was always light inside, coming from the menorah. The parochet, the veil, that's what you see when you walk in the front door. Those are the things that you see. And there's other tables that hold the implements of these altars, if you will. The lighting tongs for that, the handling of the bread over here. There's other stuff in there, but these are the main things inside the sanctuary. And then you get inside that parochet, of course, and that's the Holy of Holies, and that's where the Ark sat, the Aron HaKodesh, the Aron HaEdut, the Aron HaBrit. It goes by all three of those names, the Holy Ark, the Ark of the Testimony, the Ark of the Covenant. All three of those names are legitimate for that object. And of course, on the Kaporet, the cover seat, a lot of people call it mercy seat, is the Kaporet. It's the place of atonement. And on top of that sat those two Keravim, which we talked about a little bit in the men's class, because they are the close ones. That's as close as you can get to God, is those two winged creatures that hover over him, one of whom fell. Outside, near the altar, is where the Kohanim prepare. And much of what they prepare for is for going inside the door. You don't just walk in the gate of the temple, sashay by the altar, and barge into the front door of the sanctuary and walk up here. Why do I sound a little facetious there? Because we have to teach our children to treat this place as holy. You understanding me? So that they will honor Elohim and understand what holiness is. We ourselves ought to treat it as holy. If some honorable person, let's use some righteous man. There's no one righteous. No, not one. Who can I use? If Yeshua himself were going to be here today and you knew it, and everybody called you and said, guess what? Yeshua showed up. He's going to be at the sanctuary today. Are you going to come in here in shorts and jeans and torn clothes and rags? Why do you do it now? Isn't Messiah in your brother? Don't we deserve the respect of one another as if Messiah is in us? What am I getting at? We ought to elevate our worship. You wonder why the congregations in this country are going... Go to some of the other congregations. Thankfully, you know, if as a man, if I went to some other congregations, I would struggle the way women dress. It would bother me. I'd have to be like this. I don't struggle with lust, but that's wrong for women to dress provocatively and go to a place of worship. It's wrong. This is a holy place. And the priest had to prepare to go into just the front door of this sanctuary. Are you with me? What did they have to do? They themselves had to first wash. Before they could touch anything, before they could minister to the people coming in and bringing their offerings, they themselves had to wash. Right? And then, of course, they had to wash the animal. They had to wash the offering. Did you catch that as you were reading? There was a lot of washing going on. All right? So everything had to be washed, and everything had to be prepared. And they didn't just, you know, grab the blood up in a bucket and you know, like I used to, yeah, we raised hogs when I was a kid. And I used to grab that slop bucket and just wander out to the That's not how it was done. It was very careful. And he would get a vessel of blood to take inside of there and walk very carefully. He couldn't be touched before he went in. That blood couldn't be violated in any way. He may have put his hand over the top of it because he had to go in to make an offering inside that sanctuary. So he'd go in the door and he would approach these places. Depending on which offering it was, that's what told him where to go. Either this altar or this altar. Did you see all of that? And so he would go to the requisite altar and do whatever it was. This one had four horns on it, and the blood was applied to those at times, sprinkled at the base of it. All right? And I may get some things wrong just because I'm trying to wing it here. I don't want to get too bogged down into the details, but you go study it. Okay? So there was a protocol based on what kind of offering was offered right here. And all of it is talking about getting us inside and up to the veil. All of it is driving us to this place right here. And in these offerings, now there are other offerings in the scriptures, and I'll mention one here in a little bit, I hope. But in the ones that we read about, the furthest you got was up to the veil. And that was with the chatat, the sin offering. All of this is a picture of what Messiah did for us. And the whole purpose of it, what was driving them, what was motivating them, is they wanted to be in the presence of Almighty God. That was the whole purpose. We talked about it in the men's class this morning. It was about getting close. It was about approaching Elohim and seeing His glory. And that's exactly what happened. That is what happened when they made the offerings and when they first came out of Mitzrayim. They went out to that mountain and they made those offerings, and next thing you know, they are seeing God. Go read Exodus. They saw Him. They saw His feet. They saw the veil of time and distance pulled aside, and they beheld the throne room of Elohim. They looked up at a sea of stone, and they saw God's feet sitting on top of it. It's beautiful. And that was the whole purpose of the offerings. And that is why Messiah came and died for you and me, is to give us access to the very throne room and see the glory of Elohim. And we're not supposed to let our guard down and just become common people down here, just sashaying about like everybody else in the world, as if we're going to go into His throne room at the end of this thing, even if we just live like pigs. He's not going to let pigs into the sanctuary. He expects all of us to live a clean life. If you've been washed by the blood of Messiah, live a clean life. His blood deserves it. This sanctuary, the whole thing, I've already said it, represents Messiah Himself. I'm going to try to paint a picture here for you. The body of Messiah, His physical body, which still exists, although Trinitarian doctrine in the Catholic Church will teach you otherwise, but the human body of Messiah Yeshua still exists. And He is standing beside the throne room, which is what this place represents. So Yeshua is standing right here. Actually, He's on the other side, the bread of the presence. At His right hand. Right? The bread of life is standing beside the throne up in heaven right now. Get that in your mind. There is a human being standing before an Almighty God. Hallelujah. And Yeshua the man, the human being, who is absolutely divine, but He is the manifest presence of Elohim. He is the express, detailed image of the Creator God. He's a physical manifestation of God forever. And that's what this tabernacle represents. This tabernacle represents His ministry, what He accomplished for us. So if we are in the tabernacle, we see Elohim. You can say the same thing. If you are in Messiah, and we read it this morning in our prayer reading, if you are in Messiah, you see Elohim. That's the goal. And though none of us have beheld Him with our eyes, if you have given your life to the Messiah, You have seen him. You understand that there is a creator. You have no doubt that you were created. You have no doubt that there is order and reason and structure to this universe that we live in. And you have no doubt that there is an end coming and that there is a glorious end to this thing that's going on. So you don't fear what's going on in this world. Are you guys? So this tent is the very opening itself, if you will. The door in the tent is the door of Messiah. So if we're inside the sanctuary, we behold his whole ministry. Are you with me? Go there in your mind. Picture it right here.
Picture, if you will.
Take a moment and go there and understand that if you are in Messiah, you see the totality of his ministry. You see what he's done to you by becoming all of these offerings that we've read about this week. There is therefore no condemnation to those who walk not after the flesh in Yeshua HaMashiach. That's literal. If you are in Messiah, you are a new creation. Forget the junk that happened out there. That was the point of you coming to this altar. Are you with me? In another place, in Romans 12:5, it says, so we, who's the we there? Let's make sure we put it in context. It's not Mickey Mouse and his, who is it? Who's the we in that verse? It's us, it's you and me. It's those who profess faith in Messiah. We, being many, are one body in Mashiach. You walked into the body of Messiah when you came into his tabernacle, which is represented by his flesh. How does it happen in our minds? How can we wrap our heads around it? What is the mechanism that moves us through the door of the tabernacle of his body? It's your confession. If you trust inside of your heart and confess with your mouth that Yeshua is Yahweh, you are rescued. You are brought into the sanctuary. You see the ministry of the Messiah. For as in Adam, all die, even so in Mashiach, everyone is made alive. For in Mashiach Yeshua, neither circumcision is anything nor uncircumcision, but it is a new creation that counts. That renewal happens right there. That's what this altar represents. And really, you could say it starts at the gate. Didn't Yeshua call himself the gate as well? It really starts at the gate. Before you come into the gate, which is out here, that's what this little table here represents. Before you come into the gate of the whole tabernacle compound, hate to use that word, but that's what it was. Before you come into that gate, you paid a ransom, didn't you? An equal ransom. Everybody paid the exact same thing, right? No one's sin is greater than the next guy, right? But then you have to come further. You not only have to recognize that Yeshua died for everybody, you have to come to this altar as well. And what do you have to do here? You have to recognize he died because of me. Not because of everybody else, because of me. And I think sometimes we lose sight of that fact. And if we live our whole lives and never think, if we live our whole lives after we come into the gate and make the confession that we believe in the Messiah who brought us into this tabernacle, and we come in, but we don't ever think about the fact that he died for the sins that we commit, that's a problem. And you're never going to get there if you're stuck here because you won't quit being bullheaded and admit your sin. Are you with me? We're called to this tabernacle. Think about this. We're called to this tabernacle by its aroma. Can you imagine? You're on your camel, trotting along, a little hungry, it's hot, and you smell the smell. Oh, man, somebody is barbecuing. Man, you smell that sweet bread? My goodness. That's what was going on. Everybody. Abba, it's funny because he's smart. He planted Israel right in the middle of the biggest thoroughfare in the ancient world. Everybody had to go through there to trade. To get from Egypt to Asia, you had to go through Jerusalem, and you had to bypass that temple, which always had the aroma of offerings going up. Did you catch that the cakes that the priests ate when someone brought a cake offering, a meal offering, what had frankincense in it? Have you ever smelled frankincense? Add that to a loaf of bread. Add that to a loaf of bread and some salt. My good, plus the meat that's cooking. Why am I saying this? Because the aroma, what does the aroma represent? It represents you and me, those of us who are bringing those offerings, those of us who are partaking of it, those of us who are the priesthood, those of us who bring, who understand that we need to be encountered with ourselves right here and deal with it, and that somebody has to die for my selfishness. Somebody's got to take my place, right? And and the action, the priesthood of that emits an aroma. It's beautiful. And so if anyone who is strange to us, we don't know them and they come in, they ought to smell that spiritually. They ought to, man, these people. If someone walks in here and they've never met Messiah, they ought not walk out without him. We're brought in by the presence, the cloud that's hanging over the tabernacle. Can you imagine? You're on your camel again in a dry and weary land, and you look over there and see this big old cloud. And it's moving with those people that are under it. I think you would go see what's going on. It's just like Moshe. I'm going to turn aside and go see what this is. Right? Then also we're called to it by the declaration of the Besorah. The Besorah is an interesting word. I'm going to read to you out of Hebrew from Yeshayahu, Isaiah, but I believe it's chapter 61, the passage that Yeshua read on the anniversary of his bar mitzvah, when he went back to his synagogue in Nazareth and did exactly what we did here and did exactly what Jason, did you hear? Jason had a Jewish name assigned to him, Yeshua, which is not wrong. It's a common Hebrew name, okay? And so that's how I blessed him this morning. I think there was a reason for that, Jason, because, and I just derailed myself. Yeshua is coming and standing at the Bema, reading his portion on the anniversary of his birth, because it was his turn. That's what it says, and I believe it's in Luke chapter 4. And what does he stand up and read? He says, Ruach Adonai Yahwa Alai Ya'an Mashach Yahwa Ita. Oti levaser anavim shelachani lachbosh v'nishberei lev likro lishvuim dror v'lasurim pekach pekach koach likro shnat ratzon la yawa. Now I'll read it in English. The ruach, the spirit of Adonai Yahwa is upon me, because Yahwa has mashach, anointed me, mashiach, mashach. Do you hear it? Anointed me to bring the Besorah. Levaser. The word inside of there is basar, which is the Hebrew word for good news, gospel. It's also the Hebrew word for a body. So you could say he has anointed me to bring a body to the humble. Makes it sink in a little bit different. What happened to the lights? We don't need them. We have the near to me. He has anointed me to bring the Besorah to the humble. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of eyes to them that are bound. Do you notice that that's not blind eyes? Have you ever thought about that? It doesn't say blind. It says bound. What does it mean? You got a blindfold on. Do you realize doctrines of men are a blindfold? Do you realize that that's how Abba has to open people's minds the most? And all of you are, you're probably, if you're here permanently, if you've decided this is your walk, that's probably happened to you. And you went, oh gosh. Why didn't I see that before? To proclaim the year of the will of Yahuwah. The declaration that the body of Yeshua is the good news of Messiah. That his death, burial, and resurrection, that's a big important part of it. The declaration of that is the foundation of the universe, if you will. And it ought not be something that we lose sight of. So we come to the gate, we pay the ransom by our trust, we go to the altar, and what do we do there? We perform smicha. You should have seen that word. Lay his hands upon. If you don't understand what smicha is, I recommend you sit through the Bar and Bat Mitzvah class. Because the Bar and Bat Mitzvah class is for our children, but it's also to teach them the elementary principles of our faith. And there are a lot of people who come out of churches who don't understand the elementary principles of our faith. And one of them is smicha, which is the laying on of hands. And to smicha means to put your hand on and press upon, to lean upon. And it's an impartation. It's you're transferring the sin off of you onto the animal. And that's what smicha, that's one of the things that is true about smicha. But that's what happens here. The one who brought the sacrifice, the one who had committed the sin, whatever it was, or the one who wanted to just make peace with someone, or whatever the offering was, it was brought here. And on just about all of them, I think, smicha was performed. And the purpose of that is to transfer sin off of the supplicant onto the animal. That's what happens right here. And the one who brought the offering, this is what a lot of people don't understand. It's not the priest who killed the animal. It's the guy who brought it. And that's what I was talking about. When we come to Messiah, we have to recognize that I put him there. I hung him on the tree. Not the Jews, not the Romans, not the Catholics, not the Polish. I don't know why I went there. Not the Irish. Me. And if someone has not gotten to that point where they've dealt with the fact that Messiah hung on the tree because of their sin, then they are not saved. If you do not have Messiah, you do not belong to him. If Messiah is not in you, you do not belong to him. If you don't recognize that it takes confession of your rotten, rebellious sin, then you don't belong to him. And if you did do that and you're not now and you're walking in sin, then there's a problem. Everybody understand that? You're going to be here a while. I'm going to go briefly through all these offerings in order. And remember, the goal of these offerings is to get us right up here. Right up here to this parochet. First is the olah. There's not an accidental thing in the design of the Torah for any reason. Abba put everything in order in its place perfectly for a reason, and it's our duty to seek it out and figure it out. The olah is brought to the altar right there. It's killed, it's cut up, and it's burnt. Yeshua, and that's outside the tabernacle, right? It's within the boundaries of it, but it's outside of the sanctuary. Yeshua is our olah. A lot of people can't wrap their heads around this, but he went to whatever Sheol is. He's our burnt offering. It's a sweet savor. There's several places in the Brit Chadashah where Shaul calls his offering a sweet savor, an aroma. The ashes of it are carried outside the camp. And the fire of it burns continually. Wrap your head around that one. I believe one of the things that is alluding to is that And this is probably dangerous for me to say because I bet some people in here won't understand it. But Yeshua went outside of time when he died. The reason I know that is because you and I go there when we confess our trust in him. We're outside of time. We're right at the base of the tree where he died. It's a transformation through time, is it not? Because it only happened once. Well, when he descended into Sheol, he was outside of time. And if Elohim is just, he had to suffer eternally for those of us who should be suffering eternally. Are you with me? That's hard to wrap your head around, isn't it? I believe that's what this eternal... There's always supposed to be a flame on that altar. We can't understand it, but just think about it. That offering got you no access inside the sanctuary. So you have to have other offerings, right? The next one is mincha, flour and oil and frankincense. And that bread was for the sustenance of the Kohanim. Kelly would have been happy as a priest just eating the meat. But he would have also had to eat the bread. Sorry, Kelly. Bread and meat. Let's eat. That part of the bread, just a part of it, is burnt up as well. And the other part of it is for the priest to eat. That sustains the priest, and it's unleavened bread. It's matzot. If you read it, if you check it in the Hebrew, it's the only other place where matzot is used is for this offering. It's unleavened bread. It alludes to Passover. Yeshua is our matzah, right? Our unleavened bread. This one gains you no access into the sanctuary either. It's for the brotherhood. It's to sustain the priesthood. It's a recognition of the priesthood as your intermediary between God and man. And of course, Yeshua is our priest, right? And so are we one to another. Next is the shalomim, the shaloms. It's plural of peace. It's not plural. It's complete shalom. Perfect peace. Smicha is performed. The animal is killed. The blood is dashed around the altar out there. It's made to smoke upon the altar. It creates a sweet aroma. It's also a burnt offering. This one is toward brothers. It's for brothers to make peace between brothers. It does not get you access into here. But again, you can't pass there unless you do those. Are you with me? Next, you have the chatat. Smicha is performed. The animal is killed. The blood is shed. The blood is brought into the tabernacle. This is the only one where the blood gets into the tabernacle. And I want you to, this one is different from all the others because this one is a congregational offering. It's for the whole of Israel. If all of Israel's sins, a chatat shall be offered. And this is the one that is referred to, and I think it's in Colossians, where it says that Yeshua has become a sin offering for us. In your King Jamesy and other versions of the Bible, it says he has become sin. That's not what it is. He's become a chatat, a sin offering for us. And that's what it's talking about. Why? Because he died for not only our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. He died for everybody. And so the blood of that one is taken, of the chatat for Israel, is taken up to the very veil. It's sprinkled on each of the altars, and it's sprinkled at the veil as well. This one doesn't go inside. The reason for that is because on Yom Kippur, that same offering is offered, but it's multiple animals, and the blood is brought in several times. And on Yom Kippur, that's when the Kohen HaGadol, the high priest, actually goes in and pours the blood on the bima. And that one saves everybody from destruction. The next one is an asham, a guilt offering. And it's a fowl, and its blood is sprinkled on the altar and poured at the base, right out there. And the sins for this offering are specifically mentioned. It's when we commit sins against one another like theft, bribery, robbery, lashon hara, deceit, those things, those foul things that we do to one another. And it's interesting to me that he puts it after the chatat. I believe this is the biggest one that we as Messianic believers have to deal with, is this guilt offering. In the Ruach HaKodesh, there's a lot of people teaching today that the Ruach HaKodesh does not convict you or make you feel bad about your sin, that it only lifts you up and makes you feel good. It's bubblegum and ice cream gospel. I've been walking with Messiah since I'm 11 years old. I can't count how many times the Ruach has pressed on me and told me how wicked I was. If you don't have the Ruach, you don't belong to Messiah. And if you're not feeling the offense that Messiah feels when you offend one of his children, you do not belong to him. This is one we got to really wrap our heads around. And it's dealt with right there. But the offering that gets us into the veil is the one that happens on Yom Kippur, which we'll read about in a week or two. But none of these are outside of the Besorah. Are you with me? This is an offering system that Messiah did not do away with. He moved. He took it into the sanctuary above, and he became every one of these. When we go into Messiah. We go into the very heart of Elohim, into his being. Yeshua prayed before he died, "Let them be echad banu, let them be one in us." Perfectly unified inside of us is another way that he said that. And it was a conversation between him and his Father. Think about that for a minute. Let them be echad banu. One inside of us, that the world may know that you have sent me. That's why I said a while ago that if we are doing it right, if we, all of us, everyone in this room and everyone who comes through these doors, if we are all pursuing this thing and pursuing holiness and pursuing the very presence of Elohim, then we're going to love each other and we're going to deal with our asham, our guilt toward one another, before we come in here. And people are going to come in here and go, "Oh my gosh, these people love each other. They're not just pretending." I long for that. And I'm not saying that everyone in here is pretending, but I'm saying there's still people in here struggling with their flesh. You want to deal with your, you know, this is a crass way to put it, but kill yourself. Please, nobody go home and take that literally. What am I talking about? Put to death the misdeeds of your body. If your mind and your body are running your mouth about your brother, kill it. Don't point at your brother. He's not the one in the wrong. You are. And if all of us have a vigilant attitude about that, then people will, I guarantee, it has happened before, where we've had someone walk in unsaved, completely lost, and walk out a different person. Batzion has achieved that before. I would like to see it that every time a stranger comes through those doors, they're floored by the glory of Elohim. Not some drummed up fake emotion, but the love of the Messiah and the love of the brothers and the unity. Echad banu. When we come into this place, we're immersed in the Ruach. That's the whole point of that cloud hanging above the tabernacle. That's a picture of the Ruach HaKodesh hovering over the tabernacle. And the tabernacle and inside the Holy of Holies is where you could not move. When the heaviness of Elohim settled on the tabernacle and the Beit HaMikdash, it drove the priesthood out. They couldn't stand it. They were down on their hands and knees crawling out. They couldn't serve. I would love for people to sense that. A sinner coming, I would love to see a sinner fall. It says, if you do this, it's in Corinthians, I believe. It's, it, the, the Brit Hadashah says exactly what I'm teaching right now. I just didn't reference the scripture, but it says it. If you do all of these things, then the sinners will fall down on their face. Why? Because the weight of God will hit them. And they'll say, those people love God. And it's not because you have the prettiest tzitzit. And it's not because your kippah is bigger than everyone else's, or your tallit has, you know, the most beautiful colors on it. We can do all these things, and they're wonderful, and they teach us images about Elohim. Everything we do is an image of something, some lesson about Messiah, but it's useless if we don't love one another. It's absolutely useless. And there are congregations out there who are messianic where it's useless to walk into them. I've seen them. It's a waste of time because they're about the letter of the Torah and not the spirit, which is love of Elohim and love of mankind and understanding that it took a dying man to get you to confess this thing anyway. It's not a light thing that we entered into. Yeshayahu said, for I will pour out water upon a thirsty land and streams upon dry ground. And I will pour my ruach upon your seed, your children, and my blessing upon your offspring. And they shall spring up among the grass as willows by the watercourses. I have a willow in my backyard. It's the fastest growing tree I've ever seen. You feed it water and it will just grow. I provide all the willow for Sukkot here, don't I? Just about. We barely planted that tree, what, 8 years ago, maybe? It's huge. Because it's got real water being fed to it. And that's why the growth of this congregation is not fixed on some mystical, magical thing. The growth of this congregation, and I'm determined, and I believe the other leadership is determined, is fixed on the life of the Ruach HaKodesh expressed in the glory of the Besorah, which is everybody is forgiven. Everybody is forgiven, and we're all compelled to walk, and we're not compelled to judge one another. We're compelled to judge ourselves and check our own faith. You stop checking everybody else's faith and watch this place grow. I know there's people in here checking other people's faith. I hear the reports all the time. Did you hear what so-and-so said? Quit running your mouth about your brother. Quit evaluating your brother. This congregation has proven that we deal with the Galatians 5 sins and the 2 Timothy sins as quickly as we hear about them. And those things that justify people getting kicked out of here, they will get kicked out. But those are very few and severe things. So shut up about your brothers. Check your own heart. And this place will explode because you'll be pouring it. Lee said it this morning, I think. We're trying to teach our kids to edify each other, the brothers and the sisters. And that's what we're trying to do in this congregation. Lift up one another in the Ruach HaKodesh. Recognize that the Messiah is. If a person comes in here and says, and especially if they stand at the Bema and say, I trust in the blood of Messiah and I want to walk with this congregation, who are you to evaluate their walk? They have accomplished all that's necessary to walk with us. It's up to Abba to cause them to grow. Leave them the heck alone. I bet that's how James said it in Acts 15, too. We do not walk after the things of the flesh, but after the Ruach. For they who are after the flesh mind the things of the flesh. You realize that tzitzit are a thing of the flesh? You hang it on your body. It has no effect on your salvation. As far as how you tie them or when you wear them. Some people probably struggle with the fact that I don't have them on my belt loops. My gosh, I've accomplished the mitzvah. I've got them hanging on the four corners of my garment. I don't want eight. It doesn't say eight. It says four. Sorry, I'm a stickler for numbers. God said four. I got that. Don't I? One of them fall off? It's all good. I check it every morning. To be carnally minded is death for yourself and for your brother. But to have the mind of the Ruach is life and shalom. I'm trying. So how do we do this? How do we perform smicha? How do we enter into Messiah? What do we do? Smicha, I've already said it means to press upon, to lean upon. And that's what we do with our trust. That's the imagery. Because you don't just confess that Yeshua shed his blood for you. You trust. If a man trusts in his heart that Yeshua is the Messiah and that Elohim raised him from the dead, and you confess that with your mouth, that's how you perform smicha. And that's where, that's what you're doing right here. And it should be done often. There is a lie out there in Messianic circles that says that people don't sin anymore. Once they come to the Torah, they don't sin anymore. That's like a neon sign. I'm an idiot. I don't know Messiah. I'm a liar. That ought to be a beacon. If you hear someone say that they don't sin anymore. We lean on his broken body and his shed blood. Yeshua said, and again I say to you that if two of you are worthy on earth, anything that they would ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For wherever two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. And when Kepha preached the Besorah the first time in Acts chapter 2, I'm going to read that, and I'll try to wrap up after that. But I'm going to read this, starting in verse 19. Just bear with me. Is everybody okay? And again, I say to you that if two of you are worthy, I'm sorry, verse 16, but this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass in the Acharit HaYamim, in the last day, says Elohim, that I will pour out of my Ruach upon all flesh. Not on some, but on all. Not on black people only, but on all. Not on white people only, but on all. Not on Jews only, but on all. Is everybody clear? And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And upon my men servants and upon my maid servants will I pour out of my Ruach in those days, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens and signs on the earth, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be changed into darkness and the moon into blood before that great and fearful day of Yahweh shall come. That day hasn't happened yet. He's summarizing the time of Messiah to the return of the Messiah. That day that we just read about has not happened yet. It shall come to pass that whoever shall call upon the name of Yahuwah shall be saved. Men of Israel, hear these words. Yeshua HaNatzri, a man from Elohim, who appeared among you by miracles and signs and wonders, which Elohim did by him among you, as you yourselves know, this man who was Kadosh for this purpose, in other words, set apart for this purpose, dedicated to this purpose, by the foreknowledge and the will of Elohim, you have delivered into the hands of wicked men, and you have executed and murdered him. Remember what I said a while ago? Yes, he's talking to Israel. But he's not just talking about them handing him over to bonds and chains. He's talking about their sin. Because they sinned, because they were living in their sin and they loved their sin, they didn't recognize him. So they handed him over. You have executed and murdered him, whom Elohim has raised up, having destroyed the pains of death, because it was not possible for Sheol, hell, to hold him. For David said concerning him, I foresaw Adonai always, for he is at my right hand, so that I should not be shaken. Therefore my heart is comforted, and my glory is exalted. Even my body shall rest in hope, because you will not leave my soul in Sheol. This is Yeshua. David is foreshadowing Yeshua. Neither will you suffer your chassid, your devoted one, to see decay. You have revealed to me the way of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Now, men and brethren, permit me. This is Kepha talking again. He's not quoting scripture anymore. Now, men and brethren, permit me to speak to you openly concerning the patriarch David, who is dead and buried, and whose sepulcher is with us to this day. For he was a prophet, and he knew that Elohim had sworn by an oath to him that the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up one to sit on his throne. So he foresaw and spoke concerning the resurrection of Mashiach. And his soul was not left in Sheol, neither did his body see decay. This very Yeshua, Elohim has raised up, and we are all his witnesses. It is he who is exalted by the right hand of Elohim and has received from the Father the promise of the Ruach HaKodesh and has poured out this gift that you now see and hear. For David did not ascend into the heavens because he himself said, Yahweh said to Adonai, sit at my right hand until I make your foes your footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that Elohim has made this very Yeshua, whom you executed, both Yahweh and Mashiach. We have to make sure that we bring the right Mashiach to the door of the tabernacle. There's fake versions of Jesus out there everywhere you turn. If you bring a Torah-breaking Jesus to the temple of Elohim, you don't get in. He has to be a perfect sacrifice. He has to be one who kept Torah. And there are people that teach that he brought the Torah. Martin Luther, that he broke the Torah. Martin Luther did, and that's why he was so frustrated with Jewish people. Because they said, you tell me he broke Torah. I tell you, that's not Messiah. Are you with me?
Yes.
The second part of that is if you have the Ruach HaKodesh, if you have confessed trust in the Messiah, and Elohim has put the very power of life that raised Yeshua from the dead inside of you, then nobody in the world could tell you that you don't have it or take it from you. Nobody in the world can tell you that you should have bought a Kia. You know what I'm talking about. No one can tell you that you don't have it if you don't prophesy. Or if you can't quote scripture, then you must not have the Ruach HaKodesh. It's your noodle that quotes scripture. The Ruach HaKodesh can put them in there. But that may not be where Abba has gifted you. Some of the people who struggle with putting the Torah on their lips are the most loving and kind people in this congregation. Do you believe that? By the same token, if there's a shred of doubt as to whether or not you've met the King of Glory and that he has put his life in you, if you doubt that for half a second, you need to come see me before you leave today. Because if all you have is a confession and you don't have the presence of Messiah, then all you have is religion. If all you have is an idea of who Yeshua is, then all you have is religion. If you don't know that you met the Son of God and that you have seen Elohim and that his breath, his life is inside of you, you're not saved. You will perish for eternity unless you deal with it. So if that is you, you need to come and see me. Our portion is Vayikra, and he called. I'm going to do one more thing and I'm closing. I'm going to read that Isaiah portion again in Hebrew. Ruach Adonai Yahweh Alai. יען משך יהוה אותי לבשר הנביא, שלחני לחבוש ונשברי לב, לקרוא לשבויים דרור, ולאסורים פקח כוח, לקרוא שנת רצון ליהוה. And that word levaser, if you look at it in Hebrew and look at the symbols, you could say it this way, a king in a body. To declare the good news, you can see it, you can read it that way, a king in a body. That's the good news. If you want to see that in Hebrew, I can show it to you. Maybe I'll draw it up. Shabbat Shalom. Page 67.
עלינו לשבח באדון הכל, לתת גדולה ליוצר בראשית, desire beauty, praise the master of all, to ascribe greatness to the holder of creation, for he has not made us like the nations of the lands, and has not placed us like families of the earth, for he has not assigned our portion like theirs, nor our fate like all their crowds, for they bow down to vanity and emptiness and pray to a God who does not save them. But we kneel and bow and acknowledge our thanks before the King who reigns over kings, the Holy One. He stretches out heaven and establishes earth. The seat of his glory is in the heavens above, and his powerful presence is in the loftiest heights. He is our Elohim, and there is none other. True is our King. There is nothing beside him. As it is written in his Torah, you shall know today and take it back to your heart that Yahweh is the only Elohim in heaven above and on earth below. There is none other. And it is said, Yahweh will be king over all the world. On that day, Yahweh will be one, and his name will be one. Yehalu et Shem Yahweh Kiddishkah Shmo Levadot. Let them praise the name of Yahweh, for his name alone shall be honored. Odo al Eretz Yishmaim Lecherem Keret Avo. Hegila Lachal Chachira Lidnei Yisrael. Am Kerovo. Alleluia. His majesty is above earth and heaven. He will raise the status of his people and cause praise for all his devoted ones, for the children of Israel, a people close to him. Praise Yahweh. Unucho yomar shuva Yahweh, revivot alfei Israel, kuma Yahweh, imenucha techa, atha ve'aron uzecha, konecha yir b'chuk tzedek v'chasidecha yiranenu, v'avur dabir adecha, al tashet b'nei meshishrecha, ki likach v'tod l'chati lachem torati, When the ark rested, Moshe would say, Return, O Yahweh, to Miriam to Israel. Arise, O Yahweh, to your resting place. You and your ark of strength, clothe your priests with righteousness. May your devout ones shout for joy. For the sake of your servant Ali, do not turn your face from your anointing. I give you good instruction. Do not forsake my Torah. Baruch atah, Yahweh, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu kadavar hachai. The Mashiach, Yeshua. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, who has given us the living word, the Messiah, Yeshua. You and keep you. May Yahweh make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May Yahweh lift up his countenance upon you and establish for you shalom. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. Shabbat shalom.